Je voudrais du soleil vert, des dentelles et des théières, des photos de bord de mer, dans mon jardin d'hiver. Je voudrais de la lumière, comme en Nouvelle-Angleterre. Je veux changer d'atmosphère, dans mon jardin d'hiver. Je voudrais du Fred Astaire. Revoir un latte
couvert. We have an agreement with the Justice Department that they will give us access to the redacted portions of the Mueller report, and they have agreed to give us, in priority order, with us establishing the priority, the underlying evidence under the Mueller report.
Judiciary Chairman Nadler moments ago breaking a little bit of news on his new deal with the Attorney General to get more Mueller evidence. Barr, though, the Attorney General under fire for the way he handled the Trump obstruction case. Democrats are vowing much more aggressive efforts. Now, Republicans debuted their own witness at that very Nadler hearing we were discussing, former prosecutor John Malcolm.
By not making a traditional prosecutorial judgment with respect to the obstruction of justice allegations, Mr. Mueller failed to fulfill that duty. By not doing so, the special counsel put the attorney general in the difficult situation of having to make that decision.
And that very witness, John Malcolm, joins me now. Thanks for coming on the beat.
That's my pleasure. Good to be with you.
Did you have a good time?
Well, it was largely ignored. I mean, John Dean got an awful lot of attention from the Republicans and the Democrats, and I didn't get asked a single question by a single Democrat. It seems that they wanted to hear what the other two prosecutors had to say and what John Dean had to say, but not what I had
to say.
Well,
as the Republican witness, we're interested, and we've been hearing from people on all sides of this. Let me play one of the more interesting but really disturbing in some ways claims that you made. Okay. Take a look.
It is almost invariably the case that someone attempting to obstruct an investigation also engages in other nefarious activities, such as destroying evidence, suborning perjury, bribing witnesses, or threatening them with bodily harm.
I thought you laid out the law quite clearly there, but you were implying that the president never did any of that. As you know, it's incontrovertible that he did that, some of which is, according to his own aides, quoted in the Mueller report, and some of which everyone remembers publicly, like telling people not to cooperate, calling people rats, raising the specter of threats to people's family about what could happen to them. Why did you choose to go that route when you know the president has done some of those things?
Well, let me begin by saying that I'm not here to defend the president's conduct. I am here to defend the rule of law. And I think that your characterization of the facts in the Mueller report are, with all due respect, somewhat hyperbolic. I mean, saying that somebody is a rat or somebody ought to cooperate or not cooperate, that's really no different, for instance, than what Bill Clinton did.
Okay, well, but I'm not doing a news program about the Clinton impeachment. Although, if you want to do that sometime, we can do that. And I appreciate your...
Sir,
I'm hanging you up for a second. I appreciate you depicting the media as hyperbolic, but I didn't invite you on for media criticism. Let's go to the quote, and I'll let you respond.
Okay.
Since you use the H word, here is the Mueller report depicting the president telling Mr. McGahn to basically falsify records. The press reported the president directed McGahn to have the special counsel removed. Trump reacts by directing White House officials, tell McGahn to dispute this story, create a record stating he had not been ordered to have the special counsel removed.
Right.
Is that not evidence of Donald Trump trying to tamper with the evidence the special counsel was getting?
No. He didn't tell Don McGahn to go to the special counsel and lie. And saying something to the press to get him to defend himself is not telling him to lie. Don McGahn said, that's not my recollection. I'm not going to do it. The president didn't like it. But he didn't fire Don McGahn. There were no repercussions for that. When he went and spoke to the special counsel, he never told Don McGahn, now, whatever it is you do, Don, you know, don't tell him about the conversation that we had about Jeff Sessions. So, trying to, you know, get a subordinate to go out and publicly defend him about.
So you're making a legal distinction. You're saying that lying to the public is different than lying to prosecutors. I think that's a fair point.
Yes.
But when you hear the reference to falsifying records, would that not be records that would be provided potentially to law enforcement?
He wasn't tampering with the record. He was asking him to create a record. And when he said, I'm not going to do it because that doesn't jive with my recollection of things, the president didn't like it. But there were no repercussions from that.
Well, create a false record. Yes, sir.
He asked him to write what the president believed to be so, and McGahn said, I'm not going to do it because I don't believe it so. The president didn't like it, but he lumped it. He took it.
Okay. And I appreciate you making your case. Let me also ask you about the other piece, which was affecting witnesses. And this doesn't, you don't have to rely on the Mueller report. Americans have now become accustomed to the way the president talks about potential witnesses. Take
right.
a listen, for example, to him discussing his former lawyer, Michael Cohen's father-in-law.
He should give information maybe on his father-in-law, because that's the one that people want to look at, because where does that money? That's the money in the family. And I guess he didn't want to talk about his father-in-law.
Don't those kind of public comments also go to the president's state of mind and intent to impact witnesses, in your view?
Well, Michael Cohen was already cooperating, so it's hard to see how that statement could impact on anything. Again, I'm not defending the president's conduct. The president does stuff all the time that is uncivil, intemperate, and impulsive, and stuff that I wouldn't do. But there's a difference between doing stuff that's impulsive and uncivil and doing something that's criminal.
Right. And I appreciate the distinction and your candor about what you say is some perhaps mistakes or uncivil comments, as you put it. Stay with me. I want to bring in
sure.
another former federal prosecutor like yourself, John Flannery. John, your views.
My views are that we have another mouthpiece for Trump. And the reason is, I believe, based on his writings, your writings, John, is that you believe the president can do anything and that he should be insulated from the Congress and that he can't obstruct justice, as John Dowd said. And you pretty much said in your memo and your statement yesterday before the Congress. I wish I'd been there to ask you questions about your belief that our president should basically be a monarch. You cited Alexander Hamilton in your address, who in that particular publication, number 70 of the Federalist Papers, spoke about how wonderful dictators are, and we shouldn't get in their way because there are things that they have to do for us.
Well, let me let
and you're
John
saying
in.
That about this president.
I love
Ridiculous.
Getting constitutional, John. You cited Hamilton, though, for the argument that a president shouldn't always have to worry that his government actions could wind him up in court. Your
that
response.
That is, of course, correct. I mean, you
well,
know,
then
with
what
all
about
due
an impeachment?
I'm going to Malcolm.
With all due respect, I don't work for the Trump administration. I haven't worked for the Trump administration. And I was in the Department of Justice for 10 years. And I have never said anything along the lines of the characterizations that were just given by this other person. Alexander
well,
Hamilton.
Read your own statement. Read your own statement.
I would invite you, please, to put out on MSNBC's website my statement for others to read. Please
I don't
do
have to.
That.
It's everywhere.
Well,
great.
It's up. Alexander Hamilton in Federalist Number 70 talked about the need to have a president who can act with alacrity and dispatch and verve. And the reason I cited that is because you should not have a prosecutor second-guessing a president when a president is acting within his core powers under Article 2, such as
and
appointing and removing officials and considering pardons.
Briefly John Flannery. Briefly and civilly, since we're being
yes,
civil.
Sir. Yes, sir. Civilly, what that particular provision said was the Republic, said Hamilton, was obliged to take refuge in the absolute power of a single man under the formidable title of dictator. That is the provision you cited. Now, as for faithfully executing the law, a president abuses his power when he goes and pardons those who investigate him, those who would talk against him. He threatens them and exchanges pardons, like his conversation that he authorized John Dowd, no doubt, to have with Flynn.
Right. It is Wednesday, the 12th of June of 2019, and you are in West Coast Cookbook and Speakeasy. I am your chef de cuisine, Justice Putnam, and our daily special is Smothered Benedict Wednesdays. Yes, there must be a separation of church and a woman's body. I insist. Not in any patriarchal way, though I am. I'm going to be by just chance, or I don't know, succession, the patriarch of the family. My God. Well, this patriarch says there is a separation of church and a woman's body. Women are equal partners in everything, and they should have autonomy over their own body. I mean, okay, that's the way it should be. And anybody talking about making infanticide illegal, it's already illegal. And if you think infanticide has something to do with embryology, then you don't know embryology. Obviously, because that's science, and science is the work of the devil. Speaking of work of the devil, boy, did I have a tete-a-tete with a bunch of, I guess I have to call them neighbors, in the general town. There was an elderly woman, someone older than me, so an elderly woman, and I must say, more around my mom's age. And my mom's a young mom. Regardless, an elderly woman had noticed a picture posted or published in the newspaper or something of the local high school kids at their graduation flashing the Pepe symbol. Of course, the argument is, oh no, that's just the okay sign. That's the circle game that's been played since like 86, and here's all of the articles about it. It's not a white supremacist symbol. Oh no, it's not. Except it wasn't nice like that. They piled on this woman in the most horrendous and vile pile-on of right-wing venom that I've seen in quite a while, and it pissed me off. Now, I didn't notice it until a bit later in the day, but within hours, she had to shut down the comments section. She had hundreds of these people just piling on her. And anybody who dared to, like, make a pipsqueak, they piled on them. Well, I don't know, maybe there's some sort of Boy Scout in me, but it really bothered me. You know, if I'm going to help an elderly woman across the street, I'm going to help an elderly woman against a bunch of fascist Nazis, because that's what we're talking about here. Or at least apologists of Nazi white supremacist fascism. I did post a separate post on the town Facebook page in defense of this woman, speaking about how, you know, the stiff arm salute could be shown, you know, as just a hail hearty to a friend. It's not the Nazi salute, it's just a hail hearty. A hearty hail, hail to my friend. It's not the Nazi salute. But if a bunch of high school kids did that at a picture during graduation day, I think that maybe a learning moment could be brought to fore. Teaching, if not these exact students, because they're graduating, right? But maybe if they were my kids, I would do it. And you can bring them together in some fashion anyway. We live in a small town. But regardless, it could have been turned into a teaching moment in which to teach kids the power of symbology, what it means to use symbols, and what is, well, I don't know. I guess they don't teach the humanities even at a young age anymore, let alone in the university. So those critical thinking skills are just not, because apparently the administration didn't care. Now, it doesn't matter whether my neighbors believe it is simply the circle game or the okay sign. They can argue all they want that it's not the Nazi white supremacist fascist symbol. Except the Nazi white supremacist fascists believe it is their symbol. get it. I know you folks get it. I'm speaking to the choir here, of course, but regardless. It was very disturbing, shall we say. So I did a couple of posts, and of course that was construed as, oh, you're just trying to troll. No one gets the learning moment here. So in a post later on, before everything was deleted by the administrator, and I really don't blame him. It really was over the top. And let me assure you, I never used any invective. I never used any curse words. I never said F you. All of it was directed my way. But I'm getting ahead of myself here. So I posted two posts. One was that I tend to get more death threats from whenever I bring up an argument against Nazi, fascist, white nationalism. Then I do when I made a joke about Jerry Garcia really being in a diabetic coma 10 years before he was actually diagnosed as being in one. And I got a lot of death threats for that. Yeah, don't make a joke about Jerry to some diehard deadheads. You might be deadheaded yourself. I never knew. But I found out real quick. But I still get more death threats, more arguments, more defenses of Nazi, white supremacist fascism every time I bring it up. And then that thread got filled up with another couple hundred invective-filled, spittled whatnots. And then I posted another one because it was reported. I was the troll. I was the hater. I was the one that I guess caused these people to lose their marbles. I couldn't figure it out. I was accused of threatening people somehow. And yet I went over the thread and I'm like, all the threats are at me, you know? They're the ones posting memes with guns. They're the ones that are talking about their Second Amendment rights. Right? Now, as an aside, this is really a very loudmouth vocal group. I'm not sure there is really that many of them in the whole valley, but they are the loudest. And they display their guns when they want to be loud and intimidating. So people of good mind and heart hunker down. I do not blame them. Now, I was accused of posting hate every day on my Facebook page. Of course, my Facebook page is used mostly to post the show notes and links diary for this show. So those were used as examples of how I am a psychological, drug-addled, drunk, on prescription drugs. I don't know. It's just the projection was really astounding. Let's just put it that way. Et cetera, commie, socialist, this, that. And this is proof of how much I'm a hater. And violent, too. This proves how violent I am. I have a quote from Pablo Neruda. A poet is at the same time a force for solidarity and for solitude. Such hate. I suppose if you're a goose-stepping Nazi sympathizer, that expression of let's get along no matter who we are, and I need some time to myself for reflection, would be considered a gross violation of their authority. Now, I also have a picture at the top banner picture on my Facebook page, in honor to my son, where in his bravery and courage last summer, took to the steps of the Oregon State Capitol, bullhorn in hand, a couple of my nieces and my eldest granddaughter, to protest the separation of families, children from their families, and also the children dying in icebox baby gulags. And he took on about a couple of dozen Proud Boys and others. He showed his bravery that day. Oh, yes, the complaint was, how would you endanger your children in such a fashion? Well, I grew up with crosses burned on our lawn for simply having students of color and various nationalities show up at the house for my dad's and mom's soirees, along with my dad's colleagues, who were also members of various nationalities and people of color. That was such an affront to the neighborhood. A cross was burned on our lawn the first time. They didn't wait for the second. But there was one on the second and the third. Until we finally convinced the cops that maybe they might want to step in. They did. So, in honor to my son, and really, I raised a good kid. We don't cower to bullies. We stand up to bullies. Bullies are a bunch of whiny-ass wimps in the long run. Two dozen or more Proud Boys who are supposed to be these brawlers. Well, yeah, I guess it could be argued he hid behind the kids because they were merely there. But the signs they held... said, what if it was your child? An American flag, which was put on the casket of my son's fiance's grandfather's casket when he was interred, held up prominently by my nieces, and my granddaughter holding a sign that says, a vote for Trump was a vote for hate. Shame on you. And my son is also wearing a Fuck Trump t-shirt, but, you know, come on. He's got a bullhorn in hand. He's a pretty big kid. Yeah, he taught boxing. And that has been also cited as an example of my hate. Really? Well, indeed, I concurred with them. I do hate Nazi, white nationalists, fascists. Why don't you? All those threads were deleted. I had a DM with the admin for the page and, you know, the owner of the page. He's too busy. He can't go through all these comments and figure it out. And like he said in the public forum, why do you look to me for these answers? I'm crazy. He's a great guy. But yeah, this is their tactic. They can shut you up, and you don't have to say a thing. All they have to do is use the most vile language, and because there's a bunch of swear words in there, all of that will just be taken away because it's causing problems. I had a lot of people saying, I don't want to have to think about that. I moved in this town so I can escape. Well, you know, I write haiku to escape, but I also am concerned about my community and the world at large. I'm still multitasking at my advanced age. Hey, what's on the rest of the menu here in the Bistro Cafe at West Coast Cookbook and Speakeasy? I better get back to the show notes and links diary here so I can tell you. Well, Heritage Foundation head and AG Barr defender John Malcolm did not like it one bit when confronted with Mueller's obstruction facts and former federal prosecutor John Flannery exposing Malcolm's own belief in the unitary monarch. I was also ordered to stop disrespecting our president. He's my president, too, they said. Oh, really? They weren't that magnanimous and generous when Obama was president. Oh, no. And don't you dare ever say, you did not dare say anything positive about Obama back then. Oh, no. But I did. On the rest of the menu in the Bistro Cafe, the GOP was forced to end a deeply unpopular recall of a gun safety lawmaker whose son was killed at the Aurora Theater shooting. Trump still has not nominated a defense secretary 173 days after vowing to do so shortly. And the hung jury for the Arizona Good Samaritan facing 20 years for leaving food and water in the desert for migrants is a victory for humanity. After the break, we then move to the chef's table where the head of Brazil's Indigenous Affairs Agency is fired amid a push to open reservation lands to commercial agriculture and mining. And in a rare U-turn after intense public anger and massive protests, Russia dropped its case against journalist Ivan Golunov. All that and more on West Coast Cookbook and Speakeasy. Bon appetit. Between a pretty long lead-in between Malcolm Flannery and Melber at the top, and then my little rant, we've gone through almost half the show. So if you go to the bottom of the homepage at networksradio.com, to the right-ish is the chat room link, monitored by Kelly, and check in there. And thank you, Kelly. To the left-ish is the Patreon, or the link to our Patreon site. Do become a recurring Patreon of Netroots Radio. Your generosity is greatly appreciated. We are unable to do any of this without you. And I'll give a more fulsome rundown of our needs tomorrow. If you would like to follow Netroots Radio, do so at Netroots Radio. Thank you, Tom. Follow me on Twitter at Justice Putnam. The show notes and links diary that I mentioned earlier is published or posted on Daily Kos about 10 minutes before showtime. Look on social media for those links as well. You can follow the show on Twitter at Cookbook West. Pick up podcasts by way of Spreaker, Stitcher, TuneIn, iHeart, YouTube, iTunes, and wherever podcasts can be found. Emily Singer of Share Blue Media brings us this first offering halfway through the show here in the Bistro Cafe at West Coast Cookbook and Speakeasy. Well, it looks there's another win for the good guys. Notch it up. Republicans failed to get enough signatures to recall a Democratic lawmaker who was fighting for gun control after his kid was killed in that mass shooting at the Aurora Theater. These ghouls tried to launch a recall effort, and the public was so disgusted they wouldn't sign. It wasn't like they didn't try. They tried like hell and couldn't do it, and they're whining still. Colorado Republican Party Vice Chair Christy Burton Brown, who was helping lead the recall effort, wrote a passive-aggressive post announcing the end of the recall. She blamed gun control groups for being so scared of the recall that they pulled out all the stops to defend Sullivan, the dad of a dead son, shot brutally in a mass killing at the Aurora Theater, who ran for office on gun safety. Gun safety. All he wanted was a red flag registry so that judges could order guns taken out of the hands of the people who were deemed an immediate danger. Like, you know, the kind who would dress up in some sort of Batman costume or Joker costume and shoot up a movie theater? Of course, she took no responsibility for the fact that her side couldn't even get enough signatures to launch the recall effort, let alone help it succeed were it ever to make it to a vote. Instead, she claimed that she will now move her sights to recall different Democratic lawmakers in the state because they believe a one-party system is blessed by their God. Dan Desai Martin, also of Share Blue Media, brings us this next offering here in the Bistro Cafe of West Coast Cookbook and Speakeasy, Smothered Benedict Wednesdays. You know, the Trump administration still hasn't submitted paperwork to the U.S. Senate nominating a new defense secretary. More than a month after announcing Patrick Shanahan was his choice for defense secretary, Trump has yet to submit the official nominating work. And Trump may be having second thoughts about his decision. Trump announced on May 9th that he had chosen Shanahan, currently the acting Secretary of Defense. Boy, there's a lot of acting secretaries. You know why? They don't need Senate confirmation. Actually, they do, but they're supposed to be interim. All right. Well, that's pushing the edges now, isn't it? In the intervening 33 days, Trump's administration has not made the nomination official. The delay is especially striking considering that it was on December 20th of 2018 when Trump first promised a new Secretary of Defense will be named shortly, and that was 173 days ago. Trump's previous Defense Secretary, Jim Mattis, left at the end of 2018 after sending a blistering letter criticizing Trump's dismal foreign policy decisions. And looks like Trump's been walking around, especially when he was overseas, asking about who might be somebody good to take over. He was actually heard asking people that exact question. And it looks like Army Secretary Mark Esper was one name that came up in the conversation. Well, right now is an especially bad time for Trump to leave the position vacant for so long. Really? Not only are the Russians coming after us, American troops are continuing to battle ISIS. Did you know that? We're battling ISIS. And fight a war in Afghanistan. And Trump has been engaging in bellicose rhetoric toward Iran and Venezuela that many fear could start a war. I mean, let's not forget to consider North Korea. Things could change there drastically. Instead of love letters, Trump might get a Dear John. Roberts of the Arizona Republic brings us this final offering here in the Bistro Cafe of West Coast Cookbook and Speakeasy. Score a victory for human beings, at least a temporary one. A Tucson jury was unable to convict a man for giving food and temporary shelter to a pair of Central American migrants who snuck into the country last year. Unfortunately, the jury was also unable to declare that he was in the clear. And so we wait to see if the U.S. Justice Department will try again to lock up a 30-year-old geography teacher from Iowa. Scott Warren's trial in the U.S. District Court in Tucson has captured nationwide attention, as it should. When offering humanitarian aid is a crime punishable by up to 20 years in prison, prosecutors were silent after their loss yesterday, Tuesday, but Warren, who volunteers his time putting out water jugs and food for migrants in the unforgiving southern Arizona desert, had plenty to say. In the time since I was arrested in January of 2018, no fewer than 88 bodies were recovered from the Arizona desert. The government's plan in the midst of this humanitarian crisis? Policies to target undocumented people, refugees and their family, and prosecutions to criminalize humanitarian aid, kindness, and solidarity. Indeed. Well, let's get on to our break, and when we come back from the break, we'll go through weather from around the world and finish up with the stories that we've curated for you today. You are listening to West Coast Cookbook and Speakeasy, and we will be right back.
You are listening to NetrootsRadio.com.
Please hang up and try again.
From a point at sea to the circles of your mind, a new force is at work for planetary transformation. New radio for a new earth.
This is Take Two Movie Review. I'm Mike Friend. This week, not your father's old McDonald. Since at least the Industrial Revolution, social observers have used the term alienation to describe the roots of humankind's problems. One area in which that alienation has been acute has been man's divorce from the natural world's mechanisms for maintaining life, nowhere better exemplified than in food production. Enter the new movie Biggest Little Farm, produced by and starring the well-connected nature photographer John Chester and his wife over 10 years. It documents their journey from their cramped Santa Monica apartment to being successful organic farmers. With their sustainability guru, Alan, they take a 240-acre parcel destroyed by industrial monocropping and turn it, after well-documented reversals, into a model of diversified farming. We meet Emma the pig and a cast of thousands, mostly four-legged, as the Chesters and their crew use what's known as biomimicry to achieve balance between ducks and snails, chickens and coyotes, etc. And it's all beautifully done. But all is not as it seems. It's obvious that mountains of cash are being expended. There's an early reference to blowing holes in their budget, explained only by the fact that there are, quote, investors. But wise ones, apparently, as eggs from Apricot Lane Farms, the name of the project now, are coveted by Hollywood food elites to the tune of $15 a dozen. Emma the Pig now has a kids' book series, and then there are the movie receipts. What's missing is a plan for scalability and its inevitable associated politics. The electric vehicle of 50 years hence won't be a hand-built Tesla, and agriculture then won't look like the Biggest Little Farm. But if you're an urban-dwelling person who eats, this is the model and the movie one you and your kids should see. This has been Take Two Movie Review. I'm Mike Friend. Catch up with us at take2moviereview.com and feed us back on our page on YouTube.
This is Scientific American's 60-Second Science. I'm Christopher Intagliata. For a long time, archaeologists have dug for the shiny stuff, the sorts of artifacts that belong in museums.
They like pots, they like jewelry and gold and stuff like that.
Piers Mitchell, a biological anthropologist at the University of Cambridge. Mitchell spends his time looking for something decidedly different from such handmade relics. The thing he seeks?
A preserved piece of human feces.
Coprolites, as they're called, are dried or mineralized pieces of poop, and Mitchell and his team found some prime specimens in a trash heap at the ancient settlement of Katalhoyuk. That's in modern-day Turkey, and dates from 6,000 to 7,000 BC. Mitchell's team ground up the poop samples with a mortar and pestle, then dissolved them and used microsieves to filter out particles of various sizes. The presence of certain molecules tipped them off that it was indeed human poop, and in two of the samples, they found the intact eggs of whipworm, an intestinal parasite that's far more likely to flourish in settlements than among people who poop and then move along down the road to a new location. The discovery thus gives us a glimpse of how human health may have changed as hunter-gatherers started to adopt a stationary agricultural lifestyle.
It's only by looking at these earliest villages, these earliest towns that were set up in the Middle East, that we can really start to understand how when humans change their lifestyle to a different way of getting food, how it can increase or decrease their risk of different kinds of diseases.
The results are in the journal Antiquity. And the findings prove that ancient poop is flush, with details about ancient civilizations. Thanks for listening. For Scientific American 60-Second Science, I'm Christopher Intagliata.
This program is presented by the Centers for Disease Control and Prevention.
Pools, water parks, and other recreational water venues are popular places to relax and stay cool, but they can be sources of serious illness. Since 2000, nearly 500 outbreaks have been reported at recreational water venues in the U.S., resulting in over 27,000 illnesses and 8 deaths. Most were caused by parasites, bacteria, viruses, or certain chemicals in the water. Parents with young children who have diarrhea should not allow their children to swim or play in the water. In addition, bathers should check the inspection scores of pools and water parks and can conduct mini inspections using test strips before getting in the water. A few simple precautions can allow you to share the fun, not the germs. Thank you for joining us on A Minute of Health with CDC.
For the most accurate health information, visit cdc.gov or call 1-800-CDC-INFO.
Hi, I'm Tom Hartman, and since you're listening to netrootsradio.com, show your progressive side and go to the donate button on the bottom of the homepage. It's progressives like you who power Netroots Radio and keep the progressive message beaming everywhere 24 hours a day. Just go to our donate button at the bottom of netrootsradio.com. Thank you for keeping progressive radio at full power.
This program is presented by the Centers for Disease Control and Prevention.
In 2017, approximately 1 in 6 high school students reported a sports or physical activity-related concussion. Immediate symptoms of a concussion include headache, nausea, and double vision. Long-term, the effects of such injuries, particularly those that are more severe, can be life-changing. Healthcare providers, coaches, trainers, and parents should be aware of the symptoms of a concussion and how to treat them. A concussion protocol should be developed that includes withholding an athlete from practice and competition until all symptoms are resolved. While concussions cannot always be prevented, they can be treated in a way that decreases the chances of long-term health problems. Thank you for joining us on A Minute of Health with CDC.
For the most accurate health information, visit cdc.gov or call 1-800-CDC-INFO.
This is a message from CDC.
After hurricanes, tornadoes, and floods, standing water and excess moisture help mold grow in your home, garage, and other structures. When you return to a home that has been flooded, know that you're likely to have mold. Mold puts your family's health at risk. If you have mold growing in your home, you should clean it up and fix other water problems, such as leaks in roofs, walls, or plumbing. Keep your children and pets out of affected areas until you've cleaned. Control moisture in your home to prevent mold growth. To remove mold growth from hard surfaces, use commercial products, soap and water, or a bleach solution of no more than 1 cup of household laundry bleach in 1 gallon of water. Follow the manufacturer's instructions. Never mix bleach with ammonia or other household cleaners. It will produce dangerous, toxic fumes. Open windows and doors to provide fresh air.
For more information, visit cdc.gov or call 1-800-CDC-INFO.
Here's the story of deep fakes, also known as how the Russians are upping their electoral interference game.
I'm Baratunde Thurston from The Onion, and also, mother, you're listening to the Civil Liberties Minute with ACLU attorney Bill Newman.
The chair of the House Intelligence Committee has made public the fact that the Russian government appears intent on influencing the 2020 elections in the United States. This time, not by releasing stolen emails and other documents, but rather by releasing fake videos known as deep fakes. Because carefully crafted, controversial fake videos are highly disruptive and hugely influential, and if carefully created, extremely hard to prove that they're fake and nearly impossible to prove who made the video. Reflect on the recent fake video of House Speaker Nancy Pelosi, which is known as a cheap fake, really low caliber, and look how much currency and traction it got. Imagine what a high-quality, well-placed deepfake could do. As Adam Schiff, the head of the House Intelligence Committee, said, "I cannot imagine anything more corrosive to a democracy than in an environment where no one can tell what is true anymore. You simply retreat to your tribe and view everything as true or false, depending on what party or what group you belong to."
The Civil Liberties Minute is made possible by the ACLU, because freedom can't protect itself.
I'm Rick Smith, and this is Labor History in Two. In 1981, the Los Angeles Dodgers dropped the first two games of the World Series to their rivals, the New York Yankees. The Dodgers would come roaring back, sweeping the next four games, and so close the curtain on one of the strangest seasons in baseball history. The strangeness of the season began on this day in labor history. This was the first day of a strike that would last until August 9th. Nearly a third of all games were canceled. The reason for the strike was free agency. The players had won the right to become free agents a year after their contracts ended. Before this change, owners could renew players' contracts year after year, effectively stopping players from testing their market value with other teams. Determined to reverse the gains won by the players' union, owners brought in Roy Graby as a negotiator. Graby had a tough reputation for representing management for General Electric and for Pan American World Airlines. He took that same hard-nosed approach to the baseball bargaining table. The owners wanted the right to receive a player of comparable value for any player lost to free agency. This would effectively discourage teams from signing free agents if they had to give up another valuable player in return. The players' union understood this was a tactic to undermine free agency. Many also saw it as an attempt to break the players' union. Sports Illustrated magazine declared it the walkout owners provoked. Finally, the two sides agreed to a compromise that kept the practice of free agency intact. In a controversial decision, baseball owners decided to split the season into two. The teams with the best records from each half of the strike-divided season went to the playoffs. Labor History in Two, brought to you by the Illinois Labor History Society and The Rick Smith Show. For more information, go to laborhistoryin2.com, like us on Facebook, and follow us on the Twitters at Labor History in Two.
It's time for Nicole Sandler's What's News from NicoleSandler.com and the Progressive Voices Network.
The mainstream media is treating former Vice President Joe Biden like he's the presumptive Democratic nominee for 2020, with cable news reporting breathlessly Tuesday on the fact that both Biden and Trump would be campaigning in Iowa that night. Biden's camp released the text of a speech he delivered Tuesday night in which he'd eviscerate Trump. Cable news dutifully reported about it all day and then actually streamed it live. Jeb Bush and Rudy Giuliani would like to remind you that the front runner at this point in the race rarely wins the nomination. The first debate between the Democratic candidates is still 2 weeks away. A new national Quinnipiac poll shows Biden trouncing Trump by 13 points in a head-to-head matchup. Five other Democratic contenders, Sanders, Warren, Harris, Buttigieg, and Booker, also beat Trump easily in the survey. The House voted on Tuesday to authorize its committees to sue the Trump administration and others in pursuit of witnesses and documents for their investigations into Donald Trump. The resolution empowers the House committee chairman to act on their own to file suit in order to enforce the subpoenas they issue in their investigations. They'd be permitted to act without a full vote of the House, which supporters say would keep the chamber clearer to both investigate and legislate. House Judiciary Chair Jerry Nadler told MSNBC's Ari Melber Tuesday night that there is progress in a negotiation to bring Robert Mueller in to testify.
You've also been negotiating with now former special counsel Mueller. Has he agreed to come in voluntarily? Is there a date by which, if he does not, you would subpoena him?
Well, we're carrying on conversations with him, and he will come in, and if we have to subpoena him, we will.
Would that be, say, by the end of the summer if he doesn't come in?
I would think it would be way before that.
Way before that? By the end of June?
I'm not going to comment. I don't know.
Thousands of protesters blocked entry to Hong Kong's government headquarters Wednesday and pretty much brought central Hong Kong to a standstill, delaying a legislative session on a proposed extradition bill that has heightened fears over greater Chinese control and erosion of civil liberties in the semi-autonomous territory. Police responded by firing rubber bullets and tear gas at the protesters. Well, we may not have Jon Stewart's biting political comedy and searing commentary on The Daily Show these days, but thankfully the 9/11 first responders have him in their corner. The 9/11 Victims Compensation Fund expires in December 2020, but is already nearly tapped out, prompting an announcement in February that future claims would be paid at a fraction of what the government supported in the past. The proposed Never Forget the Heroes Act would replenish the 9/11 Compensation Fund through fiscal year 2090, but it has struggled to gain momentum in Congress. Jon Stewart testified before Congress Tuesday, scolding and shaming lawmakers for their apparent disinterest.
The official FDNY response time to 9/11 was 5 seconds. Hundreds died in an instant. Thousands more poured in to continue to fight for their brothers and sisters. The breathing problem started almost immediately, and they were told they weren't sick, they were crazy. And then, as the illnesses got worse and things became more apparent, well, okay, you're sick, but it's not from the pile. And then when the science became irrefutable, okay, it's the pile. And I'm sorry if I sound angry and undiplomatic, but I'm angry, and you should be too, and they're all angry as well. And they have every justification to be that way. Your indifference cost these men and women their most valuable commodity, time. It's the one thing they're running out of. This hearing should be flipped. These men and women should be up on that stage, and Congress should be down here answering their questions as to why this is so damn hard and takes so damn long, setting aside that no American in this country should face financial ruin because of a health issue. The idea that you can only give them 5 more years of the VCF because you're not quite sure what's going to happen 5 years from now. Well, I can tell you, I'm pretty sure what's going to happen 5 years from now. More of these men and women are going to get sick and they are going to die. And I am awfully tired of hearing that it's a 9/11 New York issue. Al-Qaeda didn't shout death to Tribeca. They attacked America. And these men and women and their response to it is what brought our country back. It's what gave a reeling nation a solid foundation to stand back upon, to remind us of why this country is great, of why this country is worth fighting for. And you are ignoring them. And you can end it tomorrow. They responded 5 seconds. They did their jobs. Courage, grace, tenacity, humility. 18 years later, do yours. We take care of them. We take care.
And that's just a bit of what's news for now. I'm Nicole Sandler. If you appreciate these reports and the Nicole Sandler Show, I hope you'll consider making a contribution. My work is 100% listener supported, and I really can't do it without your help. Find out more at NicoleSandler.com/donate.
For accompanying us here to the chef's table at West Coast Cookbook and Speakeasy. Smothered Benedict Wednesdays. We always begin weather from around the world along the banks of the Rogue River and the Rogue River Valley of Southern Oregon on the continental United States of America, where it is currently 71 degrees, slated for a high of 101, overnight low in the mid-60s, up to around 70 maybe tonight.
somewhat of a chance of a stray thunderstorm with rain falling down, possibly later on tonight. Winds out of the north-northwest at 5 to 10 miles coming up in about an hour. Sunny conditions will continue through tomorrow, though only a high in the low 90s. Thank you very much. Grass pollen is very high. Air quality index is at 24 parts per million, and the daytime UV index locally is at 9. Barometric pressure is rising at 29.79 inches. Visibility is at 10 miles, and relative humidity is at 44%. Weather from around the world is brought to you by people's personal weather stations that they purchased. These people planted these purchased personal weather stations somewhere on their property. And these people positively live around the world. I'm hurrying up here. London is 59 with a rain shower. France is 62 with rain. Rome is 84 and sunny. Kiev is 88 and fair. Kabul is 75 and sunny. Hong Kong is 78 with a light rain. Tokyo is 63 and partly cloudy. Sydney, Australia is 66 and partly cloudy. San Francisco, California is 68 degrees and partly cloudy. And New York, New York is 67 degrees Fahrenheit fair with a small craft advisory for winds on the waterways. So take care. And that is weather from around the world brought to you by people's personal weather stations that they purchased. These people planted these purchased personal weather stations somewhere on their property. And these people positively live around the world. Lisandra Paraguso of Reuters brings us this first amuse-bouche here at the chef's table at West Coast Cookbook and Speakeasy. The head of Brazil's Indigenous Affairs Agency said he was fired due to pressure from the agriculture ministry under which President Bolsonaro is seeking to open reservation lands to commercial agriculture and mining. And the ministry confirmed it. In remarks to agency employees, the official blamed Luiz Antonio Naban Garcia, Secretary of Land Affairs in the Ministry of Agriculture, for his dismissal. Frida said Bolsonaro was very poorly advised. Well, they've been trying to open up the Amazon, and what are all those indigenous tribes doing on their minerals, gas, and farmland?
Je te donne ce mon amour pour la vie entière. La promesse de me trouver à tes genoux. Aussitôt que tu m'appelles, rester toujours fidèle. C'est tout, c'est tout. Je te donne tous mes printemps, mes étés de mai. Mes automnes, quand les feuilles tombent partout. Si ce n'est pas une bonne affaire, je te donne tous mes hivers, c'est tout.
Andrew Osborne and Vladimir Soldotkin of Reuters brings us this final amuse-bouche here at the chef's table at West Coast Cookbook and Speakeasy. Russian police abruptly dropped drug charges against journalist Ivan Guvanov, a rare U-turn by authorities in the face of anger from his supporters who had alleged he was framed for his reporting and had threatened to stage a mass protest in Moscow. Well, it put Moscow in a tenable position. If they cracked down hard, that would look bad. And if they didn't do anything, then it would be, showing their weakness. And Russian journalists critical of authorities have led a dangerous existence, sometimes threatened physically, attacked, and even murdered for their work. So this is good news, but he is out, and you never know what convenient calamity could befall him. I hope he's safe. All right, that brings us to the end of our broadcast period for the day. But you know that Netroots Radio is going to broadcast on. In fact, we're going to meet up tomorrow for Metro Shrimp and Grist Thursdays. So stay tuned to Netroots Radio all day and all night for all the breaking news as it breaks. And we'll meet up here tomorrow, right here, in West Coast Cookbook and Speakeasy. Bon appetit.
Je voudrais du soleil vert, des dentelles et des théières, des photos de bord de mer, d'un mangeadin d'hiver. Je voudrais de la lumière, comme en Nouvelle-Angleterre. Je veux changer d'atmosphère, d'un mangeadin d'hiver. Je voudrais du Fred Astaire, revoir un latte coeur. Je voudrais toujours te plaire dans mon jardin d'hiver. Je veux déjeuner par terre comme au long de golfe clair, t'embrasser les yeux ouverts dans mon jardin d'hiver. Dans mon jardin d'hiver.